The perinatal morbidity and mortality of multiple pregnancy are increased due to prematurity, congenital malformations, fetal growth restriction, twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome, cord accidents, intrapartum hypoxia, and birth trauma. The woman is also at risk due to anemia, hypertensive disorders of pregnancy, diabetes mellitus, postpartum hemorrhage, and venous thromboembolic disease. Although today cesarean is performed to deliver the vast majority of twins, vaginal delivery is possible and safe, especially when the first of twin presents by the head. As the lie and presentation of the second of twin can change following the delivery of the first, the mode of delivery should not be influenced by the lie or the presentation of the second of twin. However, this is the very reason that one of the prerequisites for a safe vaginal delivery of twins is the availability of expertise in a given unit to perform an assisted vaginal based delivery, external cephalic version, internal podiatric version, and breech extraction or emergency cesarean delivery that may be required to deliver the second of twin. Extremes of weight, that is less than 1.5 kg or more than 3.5 kg, discrepancy of weight between the twins, especially the larger second of twin, fetal compromise due to growth restriction or twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome, and conjoined twins would necessitate a cesarean delivery. Monochorionic monoamniotic twins are usually delivered by cesarean around 34 weeks of gestation due to the risk of cord accidents. Similarly, a cesarean delivery is required in the presence of placenta previa or a scarred uterus. Today, I will demonstrate how to conduct a safe vaginal twin delivery. Consent should be obtained to the possible need for obstetric maneuvers, including an emergency cesarean delivery. Two neonatal teams, which include two neonatologists, nurses, and also an anesthetist, will have to be involved. Round-the-clock access to an operating theatre is a must. If feasible, on-site ultrasound should be made available. Epidural analgesia provides adequate analgesia during labour, as well as for internal podiatric version and breech extraction or cesarean delivery, which may be necessary for the delivery of the second of twin. Intravenous access should be obtained and an infusion commenced. One unit of packed red cells needs to be cross-matched in case the need for transfusion arose, if PPH were to occur. Both fetuses should be monitored using cardiotomography with twin probes or with a fetal scalp electrode as early as possible on the first of twin and external monitoring of the second of twin. Whichever method is used, two distinct heart rate tracings should be obtained to ensure that both fetuses are being monitored simultaneously. The rest of management during the first stage of labor is as for a singleton pregnancy. With regard to the first of twin, vaginal delivery should be anticipated. If the need arises and provided that the same criteria as for a singleton pregnancy are fulfilled, an instrumental vaginal delivery may be performed to deliver the first of twin. Following the delivery of the first octree, the cord should be immediately clamped and cut. Baby should be handed over to the neonatal team. But the bolus dose of the oxytocin agent as prophylaxis against postpartum hemorrhage should be withheld because it may cause premature separation of the placenta before the delivery of the second octree. Abdominal examination. And if necessary, a vaginal examination should be performed to determine the lie and the presentation of the second octree with ultrasound scan used when there is doubt. The fetal heart rate of the second octree should be monitored continuously. An inter-twin delivery interval of not more than 20 minutes is reasonable. This should avoid too early and rapid intervention, which may lead to a potentially traumatic delivery, and excessive delay, which may cause fetal hypoxia due to partial separation of the placenta, leading to reduced blood flow to the intervillous space. If the presentation of the second octree is cephalic, a vaginal delivery should be anticipated. It is advisable to start or increase the rate of oxytocin infusion because usually there is cessation of uterine contractions temporarily following the delivery of the first of twin. If deemed necessary, the membranes should be ruptured when uterine contractions are established and the fetal head has descended. If the placentine part remains high despite adequate uterine contractions, a controlled amniotomy should be carried out after excluding cord presentation. And the Lyca should be released slowly while an assistant stabilizes the fetal head over the pelvic brim. Instrumental vaginal delivery may be performed in case of delay or fetal distress. An assisted vaginal breech delivery is performed if the second octree is in breech presentation. To minimize the risk of cord prolapse, membranes should be left intact as long as possible and should be ruptured only if necessary and only when uterine contractions are established and the presenting part has descended. for an elaborative demonstration on assisted vaginal breast delivery, please watch my video. The link of which is shown. What if the second of twin is in transverse lie? Then the options are external cephalic version, internal podalic version and breech extraction, or cesarean delivery. Gel or powder is applied on the maternal abdomen. The fetus should be rotated to a cephalic presentation with both hands, which are used to apply pressure on both fetal poles, maintaining flexion of the fetal body. Following successful version, the fetal attitude should be maintained for a few minutes. If the external cephalic version is successful and the fetus is now in cephalic presentation, the management is as described earlier. The distended uterus, fully dilated cervix, cessation of uterine contractions immediately following the delivery of the first of twin, and a small fetal size create the ideal conditions for the procedure of internal podalic version and breech extraction. The fingers should be held together in the shape of a cone, and the hand should be inserted through the vagina into the uterus. And the fetal parts should be identified through the intact membranes. The membranes will usually rupture during the procedure. Ideally, both feet are grasped with the middle finger of the operator between the ankles. How can one differentiate between the fetal foot and hand? The toes are shorter, somewhat equal in length, and in the same plane as the big toe, which is not separated from the other toes. In addition, the foot is longer and the heel is parallel. In contrast, the fingers are long, not equal in length, and the separation between the thumb and the fingers is pronounced. Once the feet are grasped, they are orientated in such a way as to be able to apply traction. Traction should be applied downwards and backwards in line with the longitudinal axis of the maternal pelvis to bring the fetal feet into the vagina. This will enable the fetus to convert from a transverse lie to a breech presentation. The external hand can be used to aid in manipulating the fetus to a breech presentation. With gentle traction, the feet are brought through the introitus. This is followed by traction on the calves and the thighs using both hands. Once the hips are delivered, the thumbs are placed over the sacrum and the fingers over the iliac crest. During the delivery, the fetal body should be maintained in a sacrolateral position in order to enable the wider anteroposterior diameter of the maternal pelvic outlet to accommodate the wider transverse diameter of the fetal body. Delivery should be completed as in an assisted vaginal breech delivery, the only difference being the application of traction. The arms will usually be extended and the Lovesense manual is required to deliver them. Similarly, the head will be extended. Suprapubic pressure by an assistant will aid in promoting flexion and descent of the head. Once the head is flexed, forceps can be applied. If the head remains extended, then the Morisot-Smalley VA manual is required to deliver the head. During the procedure of internal podiatric version, if both feet cannot be grasped and only one foot can be grasped, it should preferably be the anterior one. One should continue to apply traction until the popliteal fossa of the other leg appears at the introitus. The other leg should then be delivered by abducting the thigh and flexing the leg by placing the thumb on the popliteal fossa and the index and middle fingers over the leg. The rest of the delivery is as described previously. How can one overcome any difficulties which may be encountered during the procedure of internal podiatric version and breech extraction? If only the posterior foot is grasped, there is a possibility of the anterior foot getting arrested at the pelvic symphysis. In order to prevent this, the posterior leg should be rotated by 180 degrees in a wide arc during traction and brought anterior. During the procedure of internal podiatric version, if the hand prolapses accidentally, any attempt at replacing it will not only be difficult but also traumatic. If it occurs, it should be ignored and one should proceed to grasping the feet of the fetus. With the delivery of the second of twin, oxytocin or ergometrine bolus should be administered. The placenta should be delivered by controlled contraction and an oxytocin infusion should be commenced as preventive measures against postpartum hemorrhage. The maternal genital tract should be examined for any trauma. The chorionicity and amniocentesis should be verified by examining the placenta. In summary, it is essential that an obstetrician is conversant with the techniques of assisted vaginal breech delivery and internal pudendal version and breech extraction that may be required when conducting a twin delivery. I hope you found this video on vaginal twin delivery, an art that is seldom practiced today, useful. Thank you.